from Electrocraft.
Welcome to Room Tone. My name is William Garrett. The room tone for today's conversation comes from Electrocraft West, my studio in Hollywood, California. The room tone is altered by the same voice you hear at the beginning of this podcast.
From Electrocraft.
That's the voice of guitarist, composer, and voiceover talent, Eric Schermerhorn. Eric felt the pull of rock and roll early when he heard records his older sister brought home, and the deal was done when he heard Jimmy Page's epic guitar solo on Led Zeppelin's Whole Lotta Love. Raised in the suburbs west of Boston, that city drew him into the local rock scene and to Berklee College of Music. As a founding member of some cutting-edge Boston bands, Eric was signed to a major label deal with his third band, East of Eden. Catapulted into the world of 80s rock excess, the first album was produced by the legendary Roy Thomas Baker, and the first tour was opening for the Psychedelic Furs. After a move to New York, a friend suggested he audition for the touring band of David Bowie's Tin Machine. That led to a long career as an elite sideman to more than one rock legend. When he tired of the road, he chose a new path, doing voiceover work in Los Angeles. Now in great demand, he works in his home studio, and in between voiceovers, he grabs a guitar. In this conversation, we talk about a time when rock stars were gods, about missing the camaraderie of making music that is now sometimes absent in the modern recording process, getting out while you're on top for a risky new career, and realizing that sometimes you just have to drop the crystal. Hey, Eric, thanks for coming in to visit with me.
Thanks, Will. Nice to see you.
Let's start where we always seem to start, I guess, at the very beginning. Do you remember your first solid connections to creativity? You know, I mean more than just playing with blocks or drawing as a kid, but more of a solid push toward creativity. You know, was it music first or something else that led you away from thinking about a traditional career path?
I think probably right before music, it probably, or simultaneously, would have been like writing, you know, in elementary school, poetry and short stories. I did a lot of short stories.
This is not the first journalism music connection I've heard of. So as you decided your direction, what influenced your choices? I mean, did where you grew up have any kind of an effect on what you wanted to do?
You know, I think music happened pretty quickly too, because I had an older sister who was like 6 years older than me, and mid-60s, I was probably three or four, she had all the Beatle records.
They're the Beatles again.
Yep. And you know what, it's true. It's like kindergarten, I remember, because was a half day, you either went in the morning or the afternoon to kindergarten.
Right.
And I would come home and go in my sister's room and put on Meet the Beatles. And I think when you have older brothers and sisters, you get influenced by them.
Yeah, no, my sister, only a couple years older than me, but she turned me on to a lot of great music during that time period.
I think in the beginning, it was holding the tennis racket, like listening to them and jumping around on the bed, like at 5 and 6 years old.
I love that. And I love that image.
That's great. And then And I think kids, you connect to the energy and you connect to the excitement of them. And my sister was in love with Paul, so she'd sit there, look at Paul, and check out George on the back. Like, she was into it, and she got me into it. I mean, I was not in love with Paul, but...
When did you pick up your first guitar?
Summer going into sixth grade.
Oh, wow, so that's pretty early.
I bought a Tisco, and it was...
I thought it was Tisco.
Tisco, probably.
That's the first electric I got, too, because... Yeah. Lowe's Hardware Store sold it as a kit.
Yep.
You got the amp and the guitar.
And that thing with it was late at night going to the department store, like 8:39. My dad drove me.
I wish I still had that.
Oh, those were good guitars.
I think I took a saw to mine to try to make it a flying V at some point in time and completely destroyed it. So,
I mean, I loved the Beatles and the Stones because my sister, but it was the solo and Whole Lotta Love that made me want to like learn the guitar.
So you thought about guitar as being a lead guitar player right off the bat.
Yeah. Like that's when I heard that guitar solo, I was like, oh my God, I got
that. That's on Led Zeppelin 2, right?
Yeah. Which,
no, when I was in the seventh grade, I traveled to South America to El Salvador, the school group. Mm-hmm. And I took, it was, you know, obviously pre Walkman days. And I took one of those cassette players that has the push buttons on the front and a set of headphones. And every cassette broke except for Led Zeppelin 2. So for 3 weeks, I listened to Led Zeppelin 2. So I know that record really, really
That's a good one.
Did you meet much resistance from your family when you decided to to get involved in that?
No. I think being the fourth kid, we had, my parents had five kids, and I think by the time they got to me, my sister, they were, you know, my older brothers and sisters got more of the brunt of.
I know. It is fun to be later on.
Later on means you can kind of get away with stuff. Because
was your family creative? Was there creative stuff going
on? Yeah, my sister is a great artist. My oldest sister could draw. My dad can draw really well. And they were always pretty much books, literature around the house. Like, my mom was a big reader. I think that's where I got it from. Why I love to read so much was from my mom.
What role did your education play in the path you chose and where you ended up?
You mean going to school in Boston?
Or well, early on, was there anything in pre-college school that focused you toward music?
Yeah, I mean, by the time I got into ninth grade, I knew I was going to do it. And I didn't play sports. I quit playing soccer and all the sports that you kind of do in middle school. Focused on music, and all my friends, I had three or four friends. It was just probably like you had blinders. Nothing else mattered.
Nothing else mattered. I
come home from school, practice, eat dinner, practice all night, listening, playing to records in your bedroom. That's what we did.
Yep. I mean, I remember that, that very, very well. And now, did you have your heart set on being sort of a band leader, front guy in a band, or?
I think you want to, and then you realize you can't.
Or were you just looking at Jimmy Page?
And I want to, you know, if I could have sing, I would have done it.
Oh, that thing. Oh, I have to sing.
Oh, right. I think once you realize you're not a lead singer, like, okay, I need to find
Rob. Once you realize you'll never be Peter Frampton.
Right.
There's just no way.
And I was, bands, man. Bands were like, there was nothing. Sorry, but athletes weren't as cool, you know.
Yeah.
There was, the Wall Street guys weren't, never. You know, you look at occupations, and it's like musicians were gods when we were growing up.
Yeah, I wish that was still the same, right?
It's true.
Little did we know.
We didn't. So we all were attracted to that. Like, I don't really want to get a day job. I don't want to wear a suit, you know. So through high school, I knew I took music classes in high school, like learned how to read for guitar and stuff, played in the stage band. And then senior year is like, you're going to college. And I was like, I don't really want, I want to just play, you know. And so then I thought, music school.
Yeah.
Hey, guys.
Berkeley was built for
us.
Berkeley College of Music was built for guys who didn't want to go to college and just wanted to play.
Which was a great school.
What year did you go there?
Fall of 79.
Right. So just after I left, because I was there, I think I left in 77 or 78.
And I remember the first week I met Amy in the lobby. And I said, you know, Amy Mann. I met Steve Vai. Steve Vai was there. They were older than me, but I met, you know, and I knew, I was like, this place is great.
There's
great musicians.
And that was the late 70s and all through the 80s was an incredible time to be in Boston. Had you been in a band in high school?
Yeah. A lot of bands.
Can you remember names? And
Crystal Raven.
Nice.
Crystal Raven was, and then we went to Raven. Because, you know.
Drop the crystal.
You got to drop the crystal. What else?
That's right.
I think Crystal Raven's the main one.
That's a good one. That's a good name.
Crystal Raven, man.
Crystal Raven, man. I mean, I can see the T-shirts and everything.
And I think we spelled it R-A-A-V-A-N.
That's brilliant, man. That is totally brilliant. And then when you got to Berkeley, did you feel like you were getting a little more serious about things?
Yeah, because I think late 70s, as you remember, like there was the whole fusion thing happening, although I couldn't play like John McLaughlin. I'd listen to it.
Right.
And then you realize, okay, I'm not that guy. And then New Way, you know, Gang of Four, all these new things started happening in the late 70s that was more exciting than fusion music.
What was the first band you got involved in the Boston scene?
I met Cindy, this lead singer, Cindy Lauger, and Akio, my friend from Tokyo. At Berkeley, I met Akio, and he had, like, purple pants on. This guy, this Japanese guy, hair like Ron Wood, right, with a jazz bass. And I'm like, with a drum machine, headphones and a drum machine. And in 1979, there was no drum machines. And he was from Tokyo, so he had one. And we started a band, a trio, with no drummer.
And what was that band called?
Ooh Ah Ah, named after a Rod Stewart record, Ooh La La.
Ah,
that's where we got it. David Robinson from The Cars saw us in a club and wanted to produce us, and he took us in a synchro. We tried to get the quote, you know, the big record deal,
right,
which is what's going to change your life.
We all know that.
We all know that one. Yeah. But we got budget. You know, David produced us at Synchro Sound, and we got Howard Thompson came up from New York. All these people from New York, you know. And Pat, you know, Where's the Hit? That whole thing. And then I joined Adventure Set, and that's, you produced that.
Yep. I worked with you guys on that. Mixed
the
singles.
And then
And you guys, did you guys win the WBCN Rumble or come in second place or something?
Second, I can't remember. Second place. Yeah.
Or runner-up, whatever.
Charles, the great Charles Pettigrew. He was a great singer.
Yeah,
man.
Down Avenue, was the name of his band. Yeah, they won that year. I remember coming to that final show.
And then East of Eden was the late 80s, and that's when we got a deal with Capitol. And that was the first record deal, 87, 88.
And what was that experience like, finally getting the holy grail of the record deal and all that sort of thing?
It was, again, you learn pretty quickly, and then you look back and you realize, wow, you know, people didn't tell us everything we should have known about. You know what I mean? You know, like, Roy Thomas Baker produced the record in London, you know, it cost a fortune, and you're like, where did all that money go? I spent like $20,000 renting vintage Marshalls. When we left, I'm like, can't we just buy them? And they're like, yeah, no, you have to rent them. But I bought it 7 times.
Yeah, nobody was really doing the math back in
you remember?
Those days. What was it like working with Roy?
It was great. I mean, he, you know, Queen and the Cars, and he told me there was 110 edits in Bohemian Rhapsody.
Wow.
Like, amazing guy.
Yeah, I remember when he came to Boston to work on a Cars record, and we all got to, you know, meet him and all that, and he's such a legendary guy.
Yeah, right.
Crazy guy.
Crazy.
And did he use his 40-track Stevens
machine? Well, he showed it to me. I went to his house apartment in London.
Because he brought it to Synchro when he did that Cars record.
And it's really small.
Yeah, it's port in two, like,
very small
flight cases.
Yeah. No, he's very proud of that machine. Those records sound amazing.
And so you spent tons of money, rented...
Tons of stuff,
and then the record comes out, and what happens?
Okay, we go on the road with the Psychedelic Furs, my first tour of America, fall of 89, which was awesome, because Richard was someone I worked with later, Richard Butler. So that was the first tour, and that was the first tour of, like, the bus breaking down, and sleeping on the bus, not taking a shower for 3 days, and then one hotel room, 5 people taking, you know the deal.
I do, I've been there, and so that was your first experience with the glamour of rock and roll. And how did it all...
And
it
hasn't, Will.
Yes, you're still playing with them?
It ended like it always ends, right? I think second record didn't do much, but they gave us a second record. Well, we turned in the demos for the second record, and they're like, don't hear the hits. Joe Smith left the company. He was running the company. And, you know, the usual, you look back and you try to figure it out. So people who were there for us had left.
Now, did the second record get
made?
We didn't,
nope.
Okay.
And then it was 1990, and that's when I was like, I got to leave Boston and move to New York.
I remember that well.
Because I stayed with you.
Because you stayed in my house. So was there a conscious decision to go from being a band member to being more of a sideman touring kind of guy? I mean, is this where that transition took place?
I think moving to New York, like late 20s, thinking like, oh, I'll find another band to play with. Like, that was kind of...
So the original thing was, I'll become a band member with some other...
Yeah, looking for that lead singer. And then you get to New York and being broke. And then a friend of mine, Reeves, you know Reeves.
Yeah, Reeves Gabrell's amazing guitarist and Boston friend. Yeah.
And he called me in the spring of, I think, 91. I was working at a studio in New York, playing guitar in commercials, Elias Brothers.
Elias Brothers, right. I remember when you were at Elias.
Yeah, I was at Elias, and he called and said, hey, man, do you want to audition for Tin Machine?
So Reeves, as a mutual friend of ours who had the good fortune to get up with David Bowie and create this band called Tin Machine, which was Bowie's sort of, what would you call it, like his back-to-his-roots rock and roll band?
Yeah, didn't play any of his catalog. He wanted to be a band member.
And so Reeves got in touch with you to join him for the tour.
Yeah, and he said... come to L.A. to audition.
Damn. That must have been a trip to meet David.
Amazing. And he was so nice. And, I mean, he's, you know, because I grew up with, like, Low and Heroes. Those are two of my favorite records.
And all of a sudden, there he is.
Yeah. And all of a sudden, he's there, like, and you're like, oh, my God.
I met him at Right Track in New York once. Yeah. And he was really nice.
Super nice. So that changed my life. That was pivotal, obviously. That was, like, and so to answer your question, like, all of a sudden, someone's paying you to play guitar.
Right.
Well, it's hard to go back to, I'm going to start a band and get a day job again to, you know.
So that was the big switch. And
not that it's better. It just is what happened. That's.
And how long were you out? There were two Tin Machine records, right? Or
right.
Just one?
I went out on the second one for a year.
Then that project was over for David.
Yep.
Yeah.
And he was such a nice guy. At the end of that tour, I remember we were in Tokyo. We did the Budokan. You know, I saw him at the end of the night. I said, hey, man, great work. You know, went to his room to say thank you very much because I knew the tour was over. And I guess the road manager said, oh, David wants to talk to you. So he said, Eric, who would you like to work with? Seriously. Wow. And I was like, what? And I had heard Chrissy Hynde was looking for a guitar player. And so I just said, oh, I guess Chrissy Hynde would be great. So I got back to New York, and like 2 weeks later, his manager called me and said, Chrissy wants to meet you in London.
Wow.
So I went to London and hung out with her for a full day in her house. Amazing woman.
Wow.
And so I was talking to her, and she said, oh, I'd love, you know, David said that you'd be great with me, but you have to move to London. And she wanted a London-based band. And I just moved to New York, and I was working on the Iggy gig. Like, Iggy had already... I'd already sent him tapes and stuff.
So obviously the Chrissy thing did not work out, but where was Iggy intertwined in all this stuff? Where did he come up, and how did that happen?
By the end of the Tin Machine tour, I remember we were in Japan, his road manager, Henry McGrogan, came up to me and said, Iggy's looking for a guitar player. And because he road managed Iggy too. And I said, would love to do it. And so he just said, make it back in the day of cassettes, just put some stuff on a cassette and send it to him.
I love it.
And so that's what I. And so when I saw Chrissy Hynde, I said that to her. I said, I would love to work with you, but I think Iggy. And she said, oh my God, you got to do that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she loved Iggy.
Wow.
So it was good.
Well, that's a tough choice between the Pretenders and Iggy Pop.
So I did Iggy for 4 years. That was another great learning experience.
I saw some incredible shows.
I know
you guys were playing with him. That was so much fun.
It's interesting because those guys, I mean, Iggy, American, obviously, but. Influenced by like Link Wray, pre-British Invasion. His whole thing was, you know, James Brown, pre-British Invasion, America, you know, John Lee Hooker. And that's where Iggy comes from, you know, that whole thing. Like he loved the Stones, but beyond that, he was not into the British like thing. He was really, which I didn't know. You know, you work with someone and then you learn like.
Yeah, I mean, it must be amazing to work with guys like Bowie and Iggy Pop, really get to know them because you're right there where they're applying their craft to its highest level. Especially live shows, especially with Iggy.
Oh, oof. My God.
And just incredible.
Force of nature, man.
Yeah, I saw that show at the Continental in New York. I was standing right, you know, pressed back up against the soundboard. The place was so packed. And it was an amazing show.
And there's some nights, man, the lines, he'd have to, you know, you guys, he said to me once, you know, you can jump in too, man, stage dive if you want to. I'm like, no.
No,
thanks.
Not tonight, Iggy.
That's your thing.
That's your thing. I just remember watching him swing the microphone around and you and Hal ducking and trying to stay out of the way.
I know. Now, that was amazing, man. I mean, that guy, unfortunately, when it's happening, you know it's amazing, but it's later you look back and go, you know, they were the real deal.
Yeah, it must kind of blow your mind. So Iggy was 4 years, and then what happened after
up until 95, and then I met Matt Johnson and The while I was with Iggy, and I was writing with Iggy. Like, we wrote a bunch of songs that got put on two records.
Let's touch on that. So where was songwriting and composing in this progression going up? Obviously, when you were working with the bands, like East DB and all that, you were writing in that situation.
And I had riffs and songs, and I guess I was always the guy looking for the right lead singer, you know, that's the quest of guitar players. Like, I want Morrissey or Bono or Robert Plant, whoever these, you know, like, they're hard to find.
Yeah. Well, that's an interesting point, though. As a lead guitarist and writer, you're looking for that person to interpret what you're writing. So you wrote with Iggy
I always had stuff. And Iggy was said one, hey, man, what do you got? I'm going to make a record. And I just had everything ready to go. Just check this out, check, you know, ideas on guitar in front of him. Not like check it out on a CD, a cassette. Because I knew he would respond to
a riff or to a groove.
It has to be in the, handing him like a piece of music on tape. He'd be like, wow, how did you do this? How many people are, you know.
Right. As opposed to feeling the force of it coming out of an amp and being right there.
And I think that works with people a lot. And then I met Matt in 95. And there was a break with Iggy and we weren't on retainer. Because that's just the way he ran his show.
Right.
And I had to work, man. So Matt said, I want to make a record. So I made the Hank Williams record with Matt.
That included our good friend Jim Fitting on harmonica.
Amazing. Yeah. And Gail Ann Dorsey and Brian McLeod.
Right, and Brian, right, on drums. Yeah.
And from that, I started working with Matt, and we started writing for the next record. And Iggy was, I mean, he wanted to keep the band together, but I had to keep working, so... That's how the happened.
And that was just one project.
Yeah.
Because Matt always just created new bands for each project. And did you tour behind that?
Yep. Yeah. Well, we did this next record, Naked Self, which came out on, was it on Sony? The first one was on Sony. I can't remember. Trent Reznor's label.
Ah.
He had his own thing. So that was up until 2000, from 95 to 2000. And in that break, when there was breaks with Matt, I did They Might Be Giants, played with them, toured with them, made a couple records. Paula Cole, played with her. Eagle Eye Cherry, then I played with Eagle Eye. So then I moved to L.A. 2000, right before 9/11, actually, 2 weeks before 9/11. And then that when 9/11 happened, remember, everything shut down.
Yeah, I do.
Records, I mean.
Yeah, the city shut down.
Everything shut
down.
For
quite a while, yeah.
So I got the Seal gig in 2003.
And what was that like? He had had huge, huge records before, but this was not at the beginning of his success. This was later on.
Yes, Seal 4 was the record, and we toured. I worked with him for 5 years. I mean, we toured nonstop and did a bunch of recording. Worked with Trevor Horn. And
you did some writing in that situation as well, right?
Yeah, which was wonderful because he's open to that, like open tunings, acoustic stuff. And, of course, it didn't end up like that on the record. It went Euro, baby.
I was recalling the night that, where did you guys play? At the Hammerstein.
Yeah.
In New York, and Dan and I came, our friend Dan Simonis, and we had way too much fun that night.
Drinking.
I wouldn't say anything like that. Just way too much fun. But the next morning, I get a phone call from him early in the morning, and he goes, "Hey, man, that was an amazing night. Seal hugged me."
Oh, Dan said that?
Yeah,
Dan
was all excited that Seal had given him a nice hug.
No, he's a great guy. And
that was fun.
That was the L.A. thing, though. I'm moving here. It's different slightly than New York.
Now, did you move to L.A. because you felt like there were better gigs happening out here?
I think having two kids, too. We had two kids in New York in the East Village. I had two kids. And you know how hard it is to raise kids in New York. My friend Brian McLeod, that amazing drummer from Sheryl Crow's, he did the first two Sheryl Crow records. And he's the one who kept saying, "Oh, Eric, you got to move out here. There's more work." You know how it is in New York. All you hear is, like, there's more work.
Well, and everybody in L.A. always tries to get you to move out here. So, I know.
But there's always more work.
I am sitting in Electrocraft West now that everyone said, "You got to come to L.A."
So that's why I moved. And he introduced me to Bill Bottrell, Linda Perry, and I worked with them. And
right.
Linda Perry
did
the Pink thing with Linda Perry.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Because Brian introduced me to all these people.
And the writing continues to this day.
Yeah.
Now, we've talked about this before, but at some point, touring got to be too much for you, so you decided to, you engineered a new phase in your career. So tell me about that.
Well, 2009 was my last tour. I toured for a year with Lucinda Williams, which was amazing. I mean, she's, incredible person, songwriter. But my kids, two boys, hitting middle school and high school, I just was like, I've missed too much. Birthdays, how many times I'm in a hotel room on Thanksgiving, making the phone call. And so it was a conscious choice, like that 2009 was the last tour. So I get home 2010, sitting in my house.
Well, I'm going to say the kids, what does a touring guitar player do if he doesn't go on tour?
Exactly.
It's like, uh-oh.
So... I'm online, which is what you do when you don't have any work. I think that's why
Facebook. I'm going to ask what you were doing online when you didn't have any work.
Facebook and LinkedIn, right? The reason why they're so successful is because everyone's out of work.
Right. Exactly.
No, but I was online, checking out, what can I do in my life? You start, and that's pretty painful. You have to reinvent yourself.
So your idea was. I like it. We're leading up here.
Ladies and gentlemen.
That's it.
No, I took voiceover. I met this woman. I said, I'm going to be a voiceover artist. I'm going to,
Now you like me, have been told, hey, you've got this great voice, and I've never, I'm dyslexic, so I stumble over all my words and I can't figure it out.
But getting in cabs in New York City, how many times? Like, hey, man, you should be in radio. So, you're in the back of the cab and it's like, you hear that a lot. I heard that a lot. And
that's funny.
Finally, my dad has that voice too. And I thought, and then you learn that the sound of your voice is like 10%.
Yeah.
You got to learn how to read the scripts and you have to learn.
Now, you've told me about this. Tell me about the voiceover schooling.
Well, I was actually writing songs with this guy from Boston. I can't remember his name, but
he was a great guy.
But he took voiceover lessons, and he became like the voice of Guinness.
Wow.
Yeah. So he recommended this woman, Nancy Wolfson, take VO lessons from. So I went and took lessons.
It just teaches you how to be a real actor with your voice? Is that what it is?
I think it has to be believable, which kind of was an interesting revelation. If it's believable, then it works. And it goes back to when I learned how to play guitar. Like, there's that period when you're in middle school trying to play a guitar solo and it doesn't sound believable. And then all of a sudden one day, it's, oh my God, that sounds like that.
You sort of cross a line into a more soulful, more...
Yeah.
The output from you is different.
Yeah, everything connects, and you're like, oh my God, that sounds believable. I could be one of those guys, you know. Wow. You know the feeling, Will, when it's like...
I could be one of those guys.
I could be. So that's, so I took for a year and made a demo.
But I remember we were out somewhere one time, and you gave me a rundown of like, okay, I'm going to say this line this way.
Oh, you say it different. Yeah, you got to learn how to...
That's sort of like voice acting, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So give us
like
some examples.
Coming up tomorrow. Coming up tomorrow, you know. Or, hey, man, coming up tomorrow.
I'll have to get you to do a voiceover for the intro of these podcasts.
The trailer thing is the best thing. Will Garrett, will he finish the podcast? No, I don't.
I love it.
I'm just a beginner, though, man. That's the beauty of it. It's so nice to be at the beginning of something.
But this has been a relatively exciting transition.
Yeah.
It's not like you're on the margins of the business. You're actually doing some amazing stuff.
Yeah, I made a demo and I got a good agent, Abrams, here in Los Angeles, and I was the voice for the Guy's Choice Awards this year, you know. Hey, coming up next, Cheech and Chong. They went green.
I love it.
What is it? They went green way before it was legal.
I love it.
So that, and then I do some TV, daytime TV shows, The Doctors, and a show called The Test on CBS, and then just lots of.
And so, explain what you do on these shows. So you're the in and out tag guy.
Promo.
Basically. You're doing the right when you go to commercial, when they come back from commercial.
Yeah. And also in show stuff. You know, like the Ebola. You know, they'll talk about Ebola, and I'll have to read a long. That's in show, and then coming up next. You know, that's all bumpers. They're called.
Bumpers, right, okay. I was trying to get the terminology.
Yeah, but it's I do it out of my house, my home studio.
Yeah, I was just going to say, this is interesting, and for people who don't know this, now that the technology has shifted so much, VO guys used to have to go in and sit with a producer in a studio somewhere, and now you have a little...
rig at home, like a Neumann, yeah, soundproofed. Yeah, it's amazing. Scripts come in, and I spend all day reading stuff and take breaks and play guitar. That's when I write. When there's breaks, I plug in and record, and it's really difficult life.
Now, do you think? Yeah, I know. You're killing me. You're killing me here, man.
But I'm a beginner. I've met the VO guys that have been doing it for 20 years, and it's like, you know, I just started.
But what I think so interesting to me is that a very successful run in being a super high end sideman to some really big stars, and then being able to transition yourself out of it at the time you want to, really, you know. It wasn't like you couldn't get, you know,
right.
It wasn't like you got fired.
No.
You decided that you wanted to do this, and then to be able to transition into another thing that's, you know, just as creative. You're basically talking solos instead of playing solos. So it's that's a really interesting
it's been
story.
Good. Yeah.
Well, that's good. Well, what's next? What are you thinking? Just continue the VO stuff? And
I think so. I mean, I'd like to do trailers, man, but that's like a closed shop.
Yeah.
That's like,
That seems to be the holy grail for
for
my brother-in-law is a VO guy.
Is he?
Same idea. Wants to do trailers.
I think he should do animation. I don't think he should do trailers. No.
Yeah, you don't want any more competition.
No, it's a great gig, and I'm getting better at it. I'm working, so it's allowing me to get better. You know, you learn on the job, kind of, don't you?
Well, of course, yeah, with everything, really. Any more music things happening in the
future? Yeah, I mean, I'm always writing with Pete, my buddy Pete.
So this is Pete and Min, and you guys have a... production company or some
Chimp is a band.
Yeah.
And we always write together. We've written done a lot of TV stuff.
What kind of TV stuff have you been
We
doing?
Did a lot of songs, got a lot of songs like Grey's Anatomy and, you know, TV shows.
Because
that's the other way. The only, you know, to make a living in music is licensing music and cranking out music for TV.
And you have to have lots of different revenue streams to be able to cobble together a decent living these days.
And I'm always sitting home writing with the guitar. So that's great.
It's not a bad life, Eric.
I know, man.
Sitting in the back behind your house saying, the doctors will be right back, and then...
The best one was they took a thing on an airplane. What do you call it where you can see bodily fluids? Like a black light?
Oh, yeah, right.
And it was urine on the tray tables, feces in the aisle, semen in the men's room. I mean, I swear to God.
It must crack you
or
up.
The other one was, the girl who gives birth to twins, the girl who has two uteruses, don't let this happen to you. Something like that.
Well, it's an amazing story from beginning to where it is now, and I'm sure it'll continue to be exciting as it goes along.
Thanks, Will.
I miss your guitar playing. You played on some amazing sessions for me over the years.
I know. Those are good. You know what I miss the most, and I guess most everyone I know, musicians would agree with me, all our friends, right? We miss the most is being in a room, guitar, bass, drum, whatever, keyboards, vocal, hanging out, the social thing with you, the producer, the engineer, you know, the sushi menu coming in, you know, that.
No, the camaraderie involved in making a record is just
that's
great.
What I miss.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, sitting home doing guitar overdubs and then sending files to someone is the way it is. And it's really, music is a communal thing and it's a social thing. And
well, especially when we were in our 20s and 30s and it was such a great hang.
And great music is, that's how it's made.
You played some amazing solo on that Bill Campbell record. We were at Water Music and they had that old AC-30. And it's great stuff.
Yeah. Well, thanks, man.
Yeah. Well, good talking to you, man. Thanks for coming in for a chat.
Sure, man.
All right.
Thanks, Will.
Okay. For more about Eric, give him a Google. There are some cool videos of him with Iggy Pop, among others. And on a day when you play hooky from work, watch The Doctors on CBS and listen for his bumpers. This song is a track that Eric wrote with Iggy Pop called Wild America from the American Caesar album. For more info, interviews, and links, go to roomtoneradio.com. Find Roomtone on iTunes, SoundCloud, and YouTube. And since I have Eric here, I'm going to let him do the Roomtone tagline.
Remember, an interesting conversation beats talking to yourself.
See you next time.
One night out in L.A., I met a Mexicana with a butchie girlfriend who I thought was a man. That took me to the alley to have a little chat. People lined up.
Remember, an interesting conversation beats talking to yourself. 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 Remember. An interesting conversation beats talking to yourself. Remember, an interesting conversation.